السلام عليكم. Good morning or good evening everyone. This is the fourth and last lecture on the male reproductive system, on the histology of the male reproductive system. The main topic today is about the glands of the male reproductive system, the prostate gland, seminal vesicle, and vulvourethral gland or Cowper's gland. And the general structure of the penis. The three male accessory glands are this is the seminal vesicle. It secretes about 70% of the testicular fluid, and you have the prostatic gland, and you have the Cowper's gland or bulbourethral gland. The Cowper's gland main function at the beginning to lubricate the penile urethra. Okay, then the seminal vesicle and prostatic glands, both of them secrete the testicular fluid besides the sperms that are formed in the testis. These glands are located along the excretory genital duct system. They secrete seminal fluid, which is essential for motility and the nutrition of spermatozoa. Testosterone is required to maintain functional activity of accessory glands. Okay. So again, the glands are three glands: the prostatic gland, the seminal vesicle, and the Cowper's gland. For the prostatic gland, it is present underneath the urinary bladder. It is an exocrine compound to tubulo-alveolar gland, as you can see in this picture. It surrounds the first part of the urethra. The first part of the urethra is called the prostatic urethra, and it is the largest accessory gland, accessory male gland. Okay. It is formed of three zones: the transitional or the mucosal part, okay, and you have the central part or the submucosal part, and you have the peripheral part. Okay, as you can see here in the transitional zone, each gland secretes its secretion directly into the urethra. Whereas in the central and the peripheral parts, the glands that are present join together to form one duct on the right and another on the left, and both ducts enter into the urethra from the posterior region. You have the vas deferens that join the ampulla of vas, join the duct of the seminal vesicle. This is the seminal vesicle, okay, and the ejaculatory duct joins the male urethra, the prostatic urethra, from the posterior aspect. The prostatic gland is formed of stroma and parenchyma. The stroma is formed of the capsule, which is a fibromuscular layer. It contains muscles, as you can see in this picture. It contains muscles, okay? The true capsule, this part is the true capsule. It contains muscles. It is formed of fibromuscular layer. Okay, and then you have the trabeculae. The trabeculae also contain smooth muscle fibers, so they are fibromuscular. And then you have the reticular connective tissue surrounding the parenchyma of the prostate. Okay, so you have here the true capsule, then you have the fibromuscular stroma, which is the trabeculae. Okay, for the parenchyma of the prostate, you have the prostatic acini. It is lined by either simple columnar or pseudostratified at some areas. You have something called corpora amylacea. Corpora amylacea are acidophilic structures. Acidophilic structures that could be present inside the acini, inside the glands, inside the prostatic gland, and increase with age. Okay, and you have, as you can see here, you have, what are these? These are smooth muscle fibers that are present in the trabeculae of the prostatic gland. The prostatic gland is formed of 30 to 50 tubulo-alveolar gland divided into mucosal, submucosal, and main acini. This is the mucosal, this is the submucosal, and this is the main acini. Okay? And they all of them surround the V-shaped urethra. Each gland has its own ducts that convey its prostatic secretion into the urethra. Okay. As you can see, the mucosal gland here, each gland send its secretion separately into the urethra via a number of ducts, whereas the middle part and the periphery, both of them, the glandular system, join together into a single duct, so single duct on the right and another one on the left. The mucosal acini are present near the urethra, and each acinus opens separately into the urethra, whereas the submucosal acini are larger and open by two ducts into the urethra. The main acini is the largest one of them, and it lies on the periphery, and it also opens by two acini. Okay. The lining of the prostate gland, the prostate is lined either by simple columnar epithelium or by pseudostratified epithelium. Okay, according to the activity of the cell that is present there. According to the activity, if it is highly active, it would be pseudostratified. If it is normal, it would be simple columnar epithelium. And as you can see here, it is surrounded by smooth muscle fibers. These are the smooth muscle fibers. These are smooth muscle fibers that are present in the fibromuscular trabeculae in between the acini of the prostatic gland. The function of the prostate is to secrete serous milky fluid that is rich in proteolytic enzymes, acid phosphatase, amylase, citric acid, fibrinolysin, and lipids. Okay, all of these join with sperms, okay, to facilitate their movement in the female reproductive system. So again, the prostatic gland secretes milky fluid. Milky fluid contains proteolytic enzymes, acid phosphatase, amylase, fibrinolysin, and citric acid, and some lipids. Okay, as you can see here, this part of the gland is lined by pseudostratified epithelium. Okay, pseudostratified epithelium, whereas this area is lined by simple columnar epithelium. Okay, so the lining of the prostate is either pseudostratified or simple columnar epithelium. We have here, this is the secretion. It is called corpora amylacea if there is calcification in it. Then and you have behind you have smooth muscle fibers surrounding. You have a fibromuscular trabeculae in between the sinoid. Okay. As the male age increase, the corpora amelia present inside the sinoid also increase. Okay. This is the corpora amelia. So as the age increase, the corpora amelia increase, and the glands hypertrophy that may lead to partial affection in the urination of this patient. Okay, so with old age, two things happen. All male would have benign prostatic hyperplasia, okay, whereas some males may develop cancer of the prostate, especially above the age of 70 to 80. Okay, for the benign prostatic hyperplasia, it happens in the central and transitional zone in the mucosal and submucosal areas. It leads to partial obstruction of the urethra. As you can see here, this is the shape of normal prostate, and this is the shape of benign benign prostatic hyperplasia. The prostate increase in size upwards, so there would be stagnant urine in this area and in this area. Okay, this may lead to increase in infection and increase in urgency to urinate and inability to completely empty the urinary bladder due to the areas that cannot empty the urine from it in the urinary bladder. Okay, whereas for the cancer prostate, its incidence increase above the age of 70, and it could be about 70% of males above age of 70 can develop cancer prostate. It usually develop in the peripheral zone, appear in the peripheral zone, so that it would not affect it would not cause any change in the urination, so it would be lately detected. Early detection is very uncommon because the disease does not give any affection, any pushing on the urethra, so there would be no symptoms. Okay, whereas it can infiltrate up to the rectum. Therefore, prostatic cancer is often, when it is diagnosed, it is often inoperable, and it has disseminated to other organs. It is best to screen for cancer prostate by using prostatic specific antigens. Okay. And again, its main incidence is above the age of 70. For the seminal vesicle, it is formed of two convoluted tubules, tubular glands that are present as the posterior surface of the urinary bladder. Its epithelium, its mucosa, is formed of pseudostratified columnar epithelium resting on basement membrane. It has a musculosa, it has a muscle layer, inner circular and outer longitudinal smooth muscle fibers. And it has adventitia, which is formed of fibroelastic connective tissue. Okay, this is the seminal vesicle, right and left sides. Okay, and it is present on the posterior surface of the prostate. It joins the ambulla of vas deferens to form the common ejaculatory ducts that open into the prostatic urethra. Okay. It develops as an outgrowth of ductus efferens. Each gland have again mucosa, muscle layer and adventitia. This is the seminal vesicle. This is the structure of the seminal vesicle. Okay, this epithelium is formed of pseudostratified columnar epithelium and it has a lamina propria, resting on lamina propria that is vascular. You have here smooth muscle fibers, a layer called musculosa. It is inner circular and outer longitudinal smooth muscle fibers. Okay. And you have adventitia surrounding all of it. The main function of the seminal vesicle was to secrete yellowish alkaline fluid containing fructose and ascorbic acid. That was the main function of the bulbourethral gland. Okay. For the Cooper's gland, it is, as you can see here, it is mainly mucus. Mainly the acini appear as mucus secreting cells. Its main function is to secrete mucus lubrication for the penile urethra during ejaculation. Okay. This is the bulbourethral gland. This is the bulbourethral gland. There are two bulbourethral glands. They are tubulo-alveolar gland. Okay. And their stroma, they have stroma and parenchyma. The stroma is thin connective tissue with smooth muscle fibers, whereas the parenchyma, they are lined by simple cuboidal or columnar epithelium. They are lined by simple cuboidal or columnar epithelium and their ducts are lined by simple columnar epithelium. Okay. The external genitalia is formed of the scrotum and the penis. Okay, this is the scrotum and this is the penis. The scrotum contains the testis, and we discussed it. For the penis is formed of erectile tissue, which is highly vascular. It is formed of cavernous blood spaces, lined by endothelium and separated by smooth muscle fibers. It have two corpora cavernosa. This part is called corpora cavernosa. You have two corpora cavernosa joined together in the middle, okay? And they are lined by thick tunica albuginea. They are lined by thick tunica albuginea. And it is penetrated by deep penile arteries, deep artery of the penis, okay? So you have here two corpora cavernosa, and then in the front you have corpus spongiosum. Corpus spongiosum, it terminates at the gland's penis. It is penetrated by the penile urethra itself. Okay, the tunica albuginea surrounding the corpus spongiosum is less in thickness than the tunica albuginea surrounding the corpora cavernosa. Okay, so the name spongiosa because it is like a sponge to avoid the closure of the urethra, whereas the corpus cavernosa becomes very hard and very thick. Each corpora is surrounded by fibrous connective tissue, which is the tunica albuginea. All corpora are enclosed in a connective tissue called fascia penis, okay? And the penis itself is lined by hairless skin, devoid of any fat, devoid of any subcutaneous fats. Again, this is the penis, this is the structure of the penis. From outside to inside, you have here stratified squamous keratinized epithelium. This is a hairless skin, with no fat, no subcutaneous fat. Then you have deep superficial. Then you have superficial penile artery and vein. And you have deep penile artery. You have two corpora cavernosa, and the tunica albuginea surrounding it is very thick. You have one corpus spongiosa. The tunica albuginea surrounding the corpus spongiosa is thinner. The corpus spongiosa contains the urethra, the male urethra, the penile part of the urethra present in it. Here again, this is the penis. The penis is formed of deep dorsal vessels, superficial penile artery and vein, and deep artery should be present inside the corpus cavernosa. This is the corpus cavernosa. You have two corpus cavernosi, okay, with a junction in between, and you have one corpus spongiosa with the urethra present inside it. The tunica albuginea, the reddish part here, is very thick surrounding the corpora cavernosa, whereas the tunica albuginea here is very thin. All of these, the penis is lined by skin, hairless skin that contain no hair, okay, and no subcutaneous fat. Again, this is the penis. You have superficial artery and vein. Okay, you have deep artery here. You have two corpora cavernosa and joined together in the middle. You have one corpus spongiosa with the urethra. Okay, and you have on the outside the skin. At the end of the penis, there is a skin part that is hanging on the surface of the penis. It is called the prepuce. Okay, the prepuce is a thin circular fold of skin over the gland's penis, and it is removed during circumcision for religious reasons and some hygienic reasons as well. Okay, so this is the prepuce. Okay, so again, this is the penis. It is covered by skin. It have corpus cavernosa and corpus spongiosa. The corpus spongiosa is traversed by penile urethra. Okay, the end of the penile urethra is called the gland's penis. The gland's penis is covered by the prepuce. Okay, again, let's quickly revise on the male reproductive system. The male reproductive system is formed of the testis. It is present inside the scrotum. It contains testis and the intratesticular ducts. Then you have the epididymis here. You have the vas deferens. The vas deferens forms the ampulla of vas that joins the seminal vesicle to form the common ejaculatory duct open into the urethra, into the prostatic urethra. And you have the Cooper's gland, bulbourethral gland, that open into the penile urethra. This is the structure of the testis. The testis is covered by three structures, tonica vaginalis, tonica albuginea, and vasculosa. This is the tonica vaginalis, and tonica albuginea, and tonica vasculosa is the connective tissue that surrounds the vascular parts that surround the seminal vestibules. These are the internal structure of the testis. It is formed of seminiferous tubules. The seminiferous tubules are formed of, this is the seminiferous tubule. It is formed of spermatogonia. Okay, spermatogenic cells, spermatogonia, primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocyte, and early spermatid. There is Sertoli cells, Sertoli cells. The Sertoli cell form blood testis barrier to protect the early spermatid from any antibody attack. In the interstitial tissue in between the seminiferous tubule, there are myoid cells. Interstitial cells, myoid cell for contraction to help the passage of sperm from the seminiferous tubule to the tubuli recti. Then you have the interstitial cells that secrete testosterone into the blood capillaries. The blood capillaries are fenestrated blood capillaries. For the spermatogenesis, the first part is the spermatocytogenesis to form the spermatocyte itself. The spermatocytogenesis is by mitosis, whereas the next phase is the meiosis phase, in which the primary spermatocyte changes to secondary spermatocyte and then spermatid. Then the last part is the spermiogenesis, which is the form of sperm. Okay. The cells present in the seminiferous tubules are the first cell are the spermatogonia cell. Then you have the primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocyte, and the spermatids. The spermatogonia are of three types. Dark type A. These are reservoir. Okay. Whereas pale type A divide by mitosis to form. Dark type A divide by pale type A. Yes, divide by mitosis to give rise to type B cells. And it replicate themselves as well. Okay, all of this is under testosterone effect. For the primary spermatocyte, it divides by meiosis to give rise to secondary spermatocyte by meiosis 1, and secondary spermatocyte by meiosis 2 give rise to spermatids. Okay. Secondary spermatocyte give rise to spermatid by second mitosis. The spermatid by spermiogenesis change into mature sperm. There is a cytoplasmic continuity between all the cells, okay, via intracellular bridges. This is a summary, a rapid summary, okay. In which a dark cell give rise to a pale cell. A pale cell give rise to B cells. B cells give rise to primary spermatocyte, which starts the meiosis and then end by spermatids that via spermiogenesis change into mature sperms. The spermiogenesis is formed of four stages, Golgi phase, cap phase, acrosome phase, and maturation phase. For the Golgi phase, the main structure that is present here is the Golgi apparatus, present of PAS material accumulate inside the Golgi apparatus to form the acrosomal granule, acrosomal vesicles, then it forms the acrosomal cap. The centriole, both of them migrate to different pools. The centriole at the end would form the basal body of the flagella that would appear in the sperm. The cap phase in which the acrosome form its cap, form a cap, and further condensation of the nucleus happens. The mitochondria start to arrange in the middle piece. All the mitochondria move towards the end of the sperm to be arranged in the middle piece. In the acrosomal phase, the acrosomal cap is formed. This is the structure of the middle piece. It is formed by outer dense fibers and the mitochondria, sheath of mitochondria. You have the axoneme. The axoneme is 9 doublets plus 2 central singlets. You have the outer dense fibers, 9 outer dense fibers, and you have the mitochondrial sheath. Okay, all of these end at the annulus. And the residual bodies, these residual bodies are phagocytosed by Sertoli cells. For the maturation phase, the sperm leave the Sertoli cell. In all of the other phases, the sperm is embedded in the Sertoli cell. And in this stage, the Sertoli cell phagocytose the residual body, whereas the sperm leave it. The different parts of the sperm are the head, middle piece, principal piece, and end piece. The head is formed of the nucleus and the acrosome. And it is 5 micrometer, as you can see here, 5, 5, 50, and 5. Okay, so you can memorize the numbers easily. The head is 5 micrometer in diameter, whereas the middle piece is also 5 micrometer in diameter. It contains the axoneme, it contains 9 fibers and the mitochondrial sheath. And then the principal piece of the tail is about 50 micrometer in diameter. Okay. It is formed of ventral and dorsal longitudinal columns. Okay, axoneme of course in the middle and ventral and dorsal longitudinal columns. And whereas the end piece is only formed of the axoneme only. Factors affecting spermatogenesis are the temperature, FSH and LH hormone. LH hormone controls the secretion of testosterone. Dietary deficiency would affect the spermatogenesis, and any systemic disease and toxins. Undescended testes should be treated in early age so that the spermatogenesis would function properly. Besides, if the testes is still present in the abdomen, it can change into a cancer. Okay, here again, this is the cells that are lining the seminiferous tubule. We have discussed the spermatogenic cells, then let's revise the Sertoli cells. The Sertoli cells are few in number, are present in between the spermatogenic cells. They are elongated, columnar or pyramidal in shape. They are resting on the basement membrane. Okay. By electron microscope, the Sertoli cell contain smooth endoplasmic reticulum, it contain Golgi apparatus, it contain rough endoplasmic reticulum, microtubules. Okay, all of these structures are present. Besides, it have two junctions, two main junctions. Junction Sertoli 2 spermatid junction. This junction is only broken after the maturation of the sperm. And another junction, which is Sertoli 2 Sertoli junction, which forms the blood test barrier. Okay. During differentiation of primary spermatocyte from B spermatogonia, The tight junction between adjacent Sertoli cells disappear. Then it therefore it permits spermatocyte to migrate from the basal to the middle zone. Tight junctions between Sertoli cells reform again, separating spermatogonia from spermatocytes. So the main function of Sertoli cell, secretion of testicular fluid, androgen binding protein, inhibin hormone which inhibits the FSH, the Mullerian inhibitory hormone that function in the intrauterine life, and it secretes testicular transferrin. It support and protect and nourish the surrounding cells, the spermatogenic cells and spermatogonia. It phagocytose also any debris that any residual bodies that are end product from the sperm maturation. It also forms the blood testis barrier. If the blood testis barrier is defective, then antibody would be formed against the sperm, causing primary infertility in the male. In between the seminiferous tubule, there is the interstitial tissue. In the interstitial tissue, we have the myoid cells. Myoid cell is present, and interstitial cell of Leydig. Interstitial cell of Leydig secrete testosterone into the fenestrated blood capillaries. The interstitial cell of Leydig appear pale, vacuolated basophilic structure, and their nuclei are active nuclei. By electron microscope, it contains smooth endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, and lipids. It is under the effect of LH or interstitial cell stimulating hormone. Okay. For the ductus, there are three intratesticular ducts and three extratesticular ducts. The intratesticular ducts are the tubuli recti, the reti testis, and the ductus efferents. And the extratesticular ducts are the epididymis, the ejaculate, the vas deferens. Vas deferens joins the duct of the seminal vesicle, forming the ejaculatory duct, and lastly the urethra. The tubuli recti are the continuation of the seminal the seminiferous tubules, and they are partially lined by Sertoli-like cells, and the other part is lined by simple columnar epithelium, cuboidal epithelium. Then the reti testis is also lined by simple cuboidal epithelium. The ductus efferens, it is the exit, efferent mean exit. It is the exit from the testis, okay? And they are lined by columnar epithelium. The epididymis is formed of three parts, head, body, and tail of epididymis. The tail of epididymis continues as the vas deferens. The main function of the epididymis is as a reservoir for sperms. Okay, this is the epididymis. The lining of the epididymis is pseudostratified columnar ciliated with stereocilia. This is the cilia. Okay, all of these cilia is stereocilia. And the thing that is present in the middle is the stored sperms. Okay. The function of the sperm is to reabsorb the excess fluid that is secreted by the testis, and as a reservoir for the testis, and it phagocytoses any remnant particles. And it is site of capacitation. What is the meaning of capacitation? Capacitation is the formation of full capacity of a sperm to be able to penetrate the ova, Full capacitation only happen in the female reproductive system in the female fallopian tube. The vas deferens is a long thin structure that is layered by thick muscle layer. Okay, it is layered by thick muscle layer. It is formed of three layers, mucosa, muscle layer, and adventitia. The muscle layer is formed of three parts, inner longitudinal, middle circular, and outer longitudinal. Okay. The epithelial lining of the vas deferens is pseudostratified columnar with stele cilia. Okay. The ejaculatory duct is the junction between the ampulla of vas deferens and the duct of seminal vesicle. It is lined by simple columnar epithelium. The main differences between the vas and the ureter. The vas is lined by pseudostratified epithelium with stereocilia, whereas the ureter is lined by transitional epithelium. Okay. The muscle layer surrounding the vas is very thick, whereas the muscle layer surrounding the ureter is thin. Both of them are lined by inner and outer longitudinal and middle circular smooth muscle fibers. This is the vas, and this is the ureter. This cell is the facet cell. The facet cell are uninucleated or binucleated, whereas the lining of the vas is pseudostratified columnar with stereocilia. The spermatic cord is formed of four main structures: the vas itself, the pampiniform plexus of vein, the testicular artery, and the cremasteric muscle. They form the spermatic cord. If a surgeon is performing a surgery in the spermatic cord to ligate some of the pampiniform plexus of vein, you have to take a very careful care about the vas deferens. If he ligates the vas deferens, it would lead to secondary infertility in this male. This is the shape of the vas deferens. It is lined by, it is formed of the vas. The vas is lined by pseudostratified epithelium, inner and muscle layer, inner longitudinal, middle circular, and outer longitudinal. There are testicular artery and vein, and pampiniform plexus of vein, and cremasteric muscles. Okay, these are the different linings of the male passages for the sperm passages. The seminiferous tubule, of course, it is lined by spermatogenic cells and Sertoli cells. And it does not have smooth muscle fibers around it, but it have myoid cells. The tubuli recti are lined by Sertoli-like cells, and the second half is lined by cuboidal cells. Okay. And then the retitestes are also lined by cuboidal cells or cubical cells, and then the ductus efferens is lined by columnar cells. And then the epididymis and vas, both of them are lined by pseudostratified epithelium. From the ductus efferens to the vas deferens, all of them have smooth muscle fibers, whereas the ejaculatory duct does not have smooth muscle fiber. Then the last part is the urethra. For the male genital gland, as we have said, the prostate gland is formed of three zones: transitional, central, and peripheral zone. The prostate gland is lined by the stroma of the prostate gland contain smooth muscle fibers, lots of smooth muscle fibers. The parenchyma of the prostate are formed of are lined by either simple columnar epithelium or pseudostratified epithelium. Okay, and they form the prostatic secretions. The prostatic secretion is milky white and it contains proteolytic enzymes. Sometimes there is concretions like this. It is called the corpora amylacea. Okay, and you have smooth muscle fibers, as you can see here in the trabeculae. The lining is pseudostratified or simple columnar epithelium. If whenever the a male person increases in age, the prostate size increases, causes benign prostatic hyperplasia. It may affect the urination by obstruction of the urethra, making it hard to completely empty the urinary bladder. Whereas above the age of 70, there is a 70% probability of having cancer of prostate, which appear in the peripheral zone, so it does not close the urethra. Thus, it presents late and mostly is inoperable, or it can be operable but metastasis has already occurred. For the seminal vesicles, there are two seminal vesicles. Okay, they join the vas deferens, forming the ejaculatory ducts. The lining is by pseudostratified epithelium. It has lamina propria and surrounded by muscle layer. The bulbourethral gland, Cooper's gland, is mostly formed of mucus secreting acini, and its main function is lubrication of the penile urethra during ejaculation. For the penis, it is formed of two corpora cavernosa and one corpus spongiosa. The urethra passes through the corpus spongiosa. The tonica albuginea surrounding the corpus cavernosa is thick, whereas the tonica albuginea surrounding the corpus spongiosa is much thinner. The penis is surrounded with skin, but surrounded by hairless skin. Okay, this is a hairless skin. Okay. These are the corpus cavernosa. The tonica albuginea is thick here, whereas the tonica albuginea is very thin, surrounds the corpus spongiosa, and the urethra is present in the middle. Again, this is the penis. The penis, the last part of the skin that surrounds the penis is called the prepuce. Okay, and it is removed during circumcision. I hope you the best of luck. Goodbye.